of our vibrant local food system, and we thank you. Yolo Food Bank has been serving the region since 1970, started as a gleaning program, and has grown to the point where we serve over 12,500 community members every month throughout the county through both direct distribution programs as well as via 64 of our nonprofit partners. Today's event supports our mission of increasing food and nutrition security and helping to create a more sustainable and equitable food system. The Yolo Food Bank has a great relationship with the USDA, and we are grateful for this opportunity to expand our impact through the county through the use of this new Local Food Purchase Assistance Agreement and the TFAP Reach and Resilience Grant. Also, thanks to our partnership with the University of California, Davis, we are able to collaborate with the AI Institute for Next Generation Food Systems that is also funded by the USDA. Through this collaboration, we will be able to provide our community with better food for better health. And now it is my honor to introduce Karen Ross, Secretary of the California Department of Food and Ag. Thanks so much.
Thank you, and thank you all for being here. I want to be very brief because I want to get to the stars of the morning, which would be Secretary Vilsack, my former boss. I still consider him a boss, but whatever. I'm very excited. This is the best way ever to start a day, and that is to see a community that has come together that with support, very important support from the United States Department of Agriculture, will have additional funding to really help us scale up what we've been trying to do, especially in the last couple of years during the disruptions that we've had, supply chain, COVID, and many, many, many other challenges. Supporting local farmers, small-scale farmers, farmers of color, women farmers, the vast majority of California farmers are on less than 200 acres. They are small-scale farmers, and we are building systems so that's more local procurement, which is so important. It's bringing some certainty, some ready-made markets to these farmers, whether it's to schools or whether it's to food banks, which we've learned are such an important distribution channel that we can now think about as part of our business model. In doing that, in supporting these local farmers with this scale of procurement, we are supporting local economies, and we're building stronger, more resilient communities that are coming together to do the most important and most noble cause that I know of. And that's what a farmer does every day, grow food for people and making sure that people in need have access to the most nutritious, which I always think is the most locally produced, but fresh. We have an outstanding partnership with other state agencies, and I have the pleasure of introducing one of my colleagues, but I especially want to call out our history of over 15 years of partnering with the California Association of Food Banks on our Farm to Family program, where we really, at that time, started focusing on the nutrition in the box. And because we are the state of California with all of this fabulous fresh produce, making sure that a good portion of that box included fresh, local produce for better nutrition. And one of my favorite partners is Kim Johnson, the director of the Department of Social Services, who houses the food bank program. I'm not gonna talk about what we're going to do with our grant. I'm just gonna say it really focuses on local procurement, seniors who are in many of our rural areas and are underserved, and farmer-led aggregator hubs to really make the system work and scale it up to new levels. Thank you, Secretary Vilsack, for making this announcement today. And Kim, it's such a pleasure to partner with you. Thank you.
Thank you, Secretary Ross, and thank you all for being here this morning. It's an honor. And I want to first and foremost, as we just finished that tour, shout out this Yolo County Food Bank, the staff, the team, the leaders, the volunteers. Thank you for what you do each and every day. And also want to appreciate the local farmers who we've had the opportunity to meet today and the partnerships that we have. A significant part of our mission at the Department of Social Services is to serve, aid, and protect needy and vulnerable individuals and families. And the $43 million investment that we are excited to partner and receive and thank Secretary Vilsack for support directly invests into this mission, supporting the goal of reducing and eliminating food insecurity across California. 100%, all of these funds will be distributed directly to 54 food banks and community-based organizations across the state, the California Association of Food Banks, as well as the California Department of Public Health and the Department of Food and Ag. In all, we estimate that this investment will provide food to approximately 250,000 California families in need, which is truly amazing. However, this investment not only represents an opportunity to provide more food to California families, as Secretary Ross just mentioned, the investment will also support local and socially disadvantaged farmers and other food producers, strengthening California's food systems and agricultural supply chain. These investments also come on the heels of yet another California state budget agreement between the governor and the legislature that included many historic first ever investments in support of California's most vulnerable. Specifically, the budget included an incredible infusion of resources for the Cal Food program, which allows California food banks to purchase locally sourced food distribution to the communities they serve. Cal Food was expanded from $8 million to an incredible $120 million in that budget, with another $60 million coming next year. It's fantastic. When paired and leveraged with this investment from USDA, food banks in California will receive a significant infusion of new resources that will help support our families and farms and communities. Today, we celebrate this impactful investment. We're thrilled to hear that in Yolo, that the food and resources will go out as soon as this week, Saturday, already getting two families in need, and just a tremendous appreciation. One of the farmers I had the privilege to meet this morning, I'd like to now introduce, and that is Hope Zapola, farmer and business owner of Fiery Ginger Farm and Spork Food Hub. Thank you.
Thank you. I'm really honored to be here today. I am co-owner, actually, of Spork Food Hub and Fiery Ginger Farm. My business partner, Shane, is holding it down back at the farm today, but I always like to give him credit. Just a little bit of background on where we come from. Both Shane and I were educators in our former life before we started farming. We both wanted to make a career change and a difference in our communities because we came from an education background, which makes a great impact on your community. So we decided to start farming. We started very small. We're an urban farm, so we're right in the middle of the city of Westlake and also now in Davis. We've always had a mission and a passion for education, so ag education of all forms, anything from where your food comes from to just learning to eat new things, trying new food, what the nutritional value of those foods are. And so we took all those pieces together and we made a farm. And what we found is that there was this growing movement to get great food into schools and to help the underserved areas of our population and our communities. And so we started to think, how could we make a greater impact? We're a small two-acre farm. And as a farmer, we speak the language of farmers. And it's not always easy for wholesale markets or other people to speak the language of farmers in terms of crops and sales and acreage and what yields and all of those things. And so we decided when the pandemic hit, it became very obvious that all of our food systems were impacted, from distribution to market access, all of it. All of the communities that were struggling with food access were not able to get food. So we took a very small CDFA farm to school grant and started Spork Food Hub with the idea that we could help farmers, of small scale farmers and family farmers and BIPOC farmers and women farmers, all access this very daunting wholesale market. And what that did is it created a window of opportunity for us to source from small farms and pack it on. We aggregate, so we then can also source from larger farms and get these into these valuable markets. It creates a stable market for farmers, which is very important, and it also allows for historically underserved farmers to be able to access these markets. The really exciting part about this funding is that it's going to allow the Food Hub and the Food Bank to continue our partnership and provide this continued, stable, thriving market for farmers. And at the same time, get quality, local, and seasonal produce into the hands of those people that need it in our community. And so we are super thankful for the funding and grateful to be here. And with that, I will turn it over to Secretary Vilsack.
Hope you're appropriately named. You're providing a lot of hope to a lot of folks, and it's a great calling. Thanks for your career as an educator, and thanks for your continuing in a different venue. It's incredibly important. To the secretaries who are here, thank you very much for being here today, especially Secretary Rojas, who served as my chief of staff in my first term as Secretary of Agriculture. And it's great to be back in the state that she has so ably served for such an extended period of time. But as I said earlier, the state of California, then Governor Brown, stole Karen from me. So I felt that I needed to get back at her and the governor. So I stole Jenny Moffitt, who was here, who was our undersecretary, who's doing a terrific and fabulous job for all of us at USDA and the country. Hey, look, folks, I think it's fair to say we have been through and continue to go through a pretty tough time. The pandemic, obviously, is still to a certain extent with us, and the impacts and the effect of the pandemic are still being felt, whether it's additional concerns and issues with supply chains, or inflation. We've been through a very, very difficult time. And I think we've learned in that difficult time two really important lessons. First of all, you get through tough times through community. You don't get through tough times every man, woman, and child for themselves. You get through a tough time by coming together and focusing on trying to provide help and assistance to those most in need. You know, as I travel across the country, I can't think of better places that celebrate community every single day than food banks and the work that the food bank does every single day. Here in this county, I've been told, learned today that there are 58 counties in California. And unfortunately, we are in the county with the highest level of poverty of any county in the state of California. And so what happens here at Yolo is incredibly important to support that sense of community, because you've got volunteers and paid staff working together, receiving donations of food products and of resources, allowing the purchase of food products, and then being distributed through a wide variety of partners, organizations, small and large, to make sure that families in need get what they need. So first lesson is the power of community. The second lesson is that every time America has faced a troubled time, a time of great disruption, we have always emerged stronger, better, smarter, more innovative. And I think that's true today. We're here today to talk about a specific program that is designed to better link the resources of USDA with food banks, and with departments of government, that in turn allow them to better link farmers who are producing incredibly rich, nutritious food, and linking that produce, those farmers, to the local need. But this is just part of a much larger effort as we emerge from the pandemic, as we emerge from this period of disruption, to create, to transform our food system. Certainly appreciate the presence of the first partner today, because she understands this, as does Governor Newsom, and President Biden does as well. We know that we have to build a more resilient food system in this country. We know we have to create more avenues for dealing with not just food insecurity, as significant as that challenge is, but also nutrition insecurity. You can be fed, but it doesn't necessarily mean that you've been fed well. And one of the great things about this particular facility is that it's really focused on not only feeding people, but feeding them well. And that's what local and regional food systems do. They create that link to address food security and nutrition security. So I'm here today to award the state of California, through the Departments of Food and Agriculture and the Department of Social Service and the Department of Public Health. And I would say the Department of Public Health oftentimes not fully recognized for the work it does every single day. I think we also learned from the pandemic, it's really important to have a strong, vibrant public health department. But these three departments will be managing $43.4 million awarded to California under our local procurement assistance program. It's really designed to create, as has been indicated, resources to better able food banks to link with local producers and those local producers to provide a quality product that then goes to families in need. Secretary Ross says that she likes California to be number one. Sorry, Secretary, for our local food purchasing assistance program, you're now the 23rd state. But you got the largest grant. 23 states, two territories, and one tribe have been part of an effort to utilize up to $400 million of resources being made available by the Department of Agriculture through relief resources and funds. This is indeed going to help hundreds of thousands of families here in California and millions of families across the United States. It's also going to link hundreds, if not thousands, of local producers, historically underserved producers, small family-sized farming operations, to a new market opportunity. And we're excited about this, and we're excited that this particular facility is where we're announcing this, because this facility is also taking full part in involving in our region resiliency program. We awarded the state of California $5 million. That is now funding, I think, 19 different projects, which is really designed to help create the capacity, first and foremost, for food banks to have access to the equipment and the storage facilities necessary to have locally produced food available for families, but also to utilize those resources to figure out creative ways to reach people who live in rural, remote areas that may not necessarily get the kind of service that you get if you live in a major city like Sacramento. So it's incredibly important for us to make sure that every family, regardless of their zip code, has access. Now, as I said, this is part of a very major effort at transforming our food system, and I want to take just a minute to talk about that. Certainly excited about the fact that the Congress passed the Keep Kids Fed Act, which was really designed to increase resources for local schools, which is also a recipient, by the way, of the kinds of products that you've seen here today. We want our kids to have access to locally produced food in their school breakfast and school lunch programs. But our schools are challenged. And so we are utilizing resources at the Department of Agriculture under what is called the Commodity Credit Corporation in two ways. We've taken around $2 billion over the course of the last 12 months or so, and basically provided that to states with the instructions to in turn provide resources to food banks to be able to purchase more product. Because we know that there was high level of interest, high level of donations, high level of concern at the early onset of the pandemic. But as is often the case when things begin to return to normal, folks have the tendency to think, well, the problem is solved. It's not solved at food banks. We're seeing a heavy traffic at food banks. So we need to continue to look for ways to provide assistance and help. So the Department of Agriculture has provided nearly $2 billion of additional support for food banks and an equal amount, roughly $2 billion for school districts, with the notion and instructions to utilize those resources through the Department of Food and Agriculture and other departments to be able to make sure that they continue to purchase from local and regional food producers. So the idea here is to build out, to strengthen that local and regional food system. But there is more coming, folks. And I laid out at a speech at Georgetown University a month or so ago, a significant number of investments that we will be rolling out over the course of the next several months. There is an effort to award and to encourage more organic production as part of a transformed food system. resources available so that folks can be mentored if they wish to become organic producers, resources to help market development for organic producers, resources to lower the cost of that transition for organic producers, because sometimes it can be pretty expensive to transition from a conventional operation to an organic operation, and that's going to be rolled out here in the near term. We're concerned about food deserts, as we all should be concerned about food deserts. Food banks can only do so much. They are incredibly important, especially in areas that do not and are not served by a full-scale grocery store. So our Healthy Food Financing Initiative is designed to provide resources to help begin the process of whittling down, hopefully over time, eliminating the notion of food deserts in urban settings and in rural, remote areas. More resources are going to go into the creation of what we'll refer to as food business centers. These will be regional locations with the staff and the resources to allow folks who are interested in establishing HOPE, a food hub, or establishing a local and regional food system, or strengthening that local and regional food system, to be able to go to these centers, get the technical assistance they need to understand how to do it, and then to have assistance and help in accessing the financial resources to be able to strengthen that local and regional food system. We're excited about the processing grants that will be awarded very soon for meat and poultry, but recognize that there's an awful lot of food that also needs to be processed that's not meat, that's not poultry. So we announced a fairly significant grant program that will be outlining in the next couple of months to provide resources for food hubs, for distribution centers, for processing of non-meat and poultry products. Excited about that opportunity. Excited about the opportunity to increase resources for farm to school. I know the first partner is very interested in this, and she was excited to know that we just recently announced $10 million, 123 projects receiving additional resources, increased resources. Over the course of the next several years, that program will see increased resources by virtue of money that we just announced this week. We know that seniors are incredibly important and oftentimes have a hard time understanding how and where to get the kind of help they need. We want them to be part of this effort to help local and regional food systems, so we've increased the Senior Farmers Market Nutrition Program, providing additional resources so seniors get discounted opportunities to go to farmers markets. Additional support and money for local and regional food marketing assistance. An opportunity for us to focus on supply chain. We've got a loan guarantee program designed. And so the point of this is that there's a tremendous effort here at investing in resources that will build out and strengthen that local and regional food system. And today's announcement is just the beginning, if you will, of that effort. Let me just simply end by saying this. There are two aspects of the local and regional food system that I think need to be emphasized. First, the important role it will play in this notion of nutrition security. You know, we understand food insecurity. We understand that there are people in need at the end of the month. They may not have the resources to be able to go to that grocery store and be able to buy sufficient food for their family. Food banks, pantries help provide that gap and that bridge, as does our SNAP program, which this administration, by the way, promoted an increase by 21% in the SNAP benefit for the first time in 45 years. We rethought the underlying formula for the SNAP program, recognizing that today things are a bit more expensive than they were 45 years ago. We understand and appreciate the importance of having meaningful benefits if you want nutrition security, access to product. We understand the necessity of making sure that those resources are directed to people most in need, and oftentimes that involves communities, particularly communities of color, who are struggling. We know that we also have to do a better job in our departments of translating the dietary guidelines into ways in which people understand and appreciate the important role that fruits and vegetables, whole grains, low-fat dairy, and so forth, basically play in a healthy diet. And so that's all part of advancing nutrition security, and at the center of that is local and regional food systems. It's also at the center of building out more new and better markets. Because here we're challenged. We're challenged because farms in America today continue to have challenges. We did an ERS study recently that identified that over 89% of our farms don't generate the majority of income for the farm families that are farming them. 89%. That means those farm families have to have other off-farm income to be able to continue to do what they love to do. So it's important and necessary for us to expand significantly the opportunities for farmers and ranchers to be able to profit. More new and better markets is one way of doing it, creating local markets where farmers have the ability to negotiate, to be able to set their own price, if you will, creates a new opportunity and a new avenue. So this is an exciting time. It's an exciting time for transforming our food system. Really appreciate being here today. Bless the work that you all are doing. It's just amazing. And one of the great things about this is the volunteers, the people who show up every single week, pack the boxes, distribute the boxes. Can't do it without them. You just could not have this facility without those volunteers. They are invaluable. But they express a sense of community. And folks, I think in this world today, we need community more than ever. So thank you all for being here today, and thank you very much for the opportunity to make this important announcement. And Karen, I've given you a list of new programs, so you have opportunities to be number one in all of those. Thank you very much. Any questions for Secretary Ross? Well, unfortunately, on this trip, headed to Reno, Nevada tomorrow to make an announcement on the Reconnect program. This is an initiative where we're trying to make sure that all rural and remote areas have access to high-speed internet. The president's been very, very focused on that. We are going to be awarding a significant number of grants, including some grants in California tomorrow. A number of 11 states, I believe, are going to get grants. And that's going to be part of a rolling set of announcements over the course of the next several months. So I will be back. I was in Fresno several months ago, 4 or 5 months ago, I guess, visiting farms during my last visit to California. Anything else?
Mr. Secretary, you were just in Fresno. You said, what about water when it's dry in California? What type of assistance are you guys willing to give to farmers?
Well, that's a great question. The United States Congress basically passed a proposal providing the Department of Agriculture with $10 billion to distribute for farmers who have suffered through climate-related, weather-related disasters in the last couple of years. We have revised the way in which we distribute those resources, and farmers in California and across the country have already received over $6 billion of that $10 billion by virtue of the good work that our Farm Service Agency folks have been doing to get resources out. That's one way we are trying to provide help and assistance. The other way we're trying to provide help and assistance is by continuing to research ways in which water that we have can be most efficiently used. Some of the great problem solvers at USDA are those who work for NRCS. NRCS has a number of programs that they are currently engaged in, climate smart agricultural programs that will help farmers and producers do a better job of utilizing those resources efficiently. And so we're obviously continuing to support that climate smart effort. I'd point out as well that we put on the table an opportunity to really jumpstart this notion of climate smart commodities, the notion that food that we produce can be produced in a way that is sustainable, a way in which it is beneficial to the environment as opposed to harmful. We expected and anticipate a lot of interest in the $1 billion resource that we made available. I don't think any of us expected the level of interest we saw. I expected that we might get a couple hundred applications. At the end of the day, we received 1,050 applications for those resources. The demand is somewhere between $18 and $20 billion of requests. So there's a lot of interest on the part of American agriculture and forestry to do a better job. I would also say, and I'll end with this, part of what we have to do in order to address drought conditions in the long term is not only support climate smart agriculture, not only support the NRCS programs and the research that will lead to better crops that use water more efficiently, but we also have to do a better job of maintaining and managing our forests. You know, as we deal with the issue of forest fires, we have to understand and appreciate that for far too long we underinvested in our forest systems around the country. And I think we now have had a wake-up call by virtue of these catastrophic fires. So we have just recently announced a 10-year strategy to essentially reduce the hazardous fuel buildup that has occurred in our forests. We just yesterday announced a $1 billion initiative to help local and state governments do a better job of working with communities to make them more fire resilient. And we also announced this week a reforestation commitment to plant 1.2 billion trees over the next 10 years in our national forest system by using money from the Replant Act. So there's going to be a lot of activity to make our forests healthier. When they're healthier, they act as better reservoirs for water, which in turn makes it easier to retain the water that we are going to need in the future. Yes, sir.
Yeah, so I have a question regarding technical assistance for all these grants that are coming out from USDA and the CDFA. Underserved farmer like myself, I haven't had the privilege to get the degrees and be able to get the assistance to sit down and write all these grants out. And I know that there's a whole lot happening with this Build Back Better. We want to make sure that the money is going to these underserved communities and farmers like myself. How can we get help with that?
Well, there is as part of the American Rescue Plan, the Department of Agriculture received resources with a direction from Congress to use a portion of those resources to hire or to invest in or to pay a series of cooperators. That these are groups and organizations that have connections to historically underserved producers, to connections to small-sized farming operations to provide that technical assistance. So initially, we awarded $75 million to 20 different large-scale cooperators that are currently now making those connections and providing that technical assistance. Our web page has a listing of all of those organizations. You may want to take a look at our webpage, usda.gov. Take a look and see if there's any organization on that list that you can identify with. In addition, we also recognize the need for perhaps smaller organizations that aren't necessarily national in scope but very local. So we've put on the roughly at least a minimum of $25 million to make additional grants to these smaller organizations. I think we received 80 some applications. We're in the process of making those awards as well. So we do understand and appreciate the importance of getting resources out. We're also working, frankly, with minority serving institutions to make sure that they, through their liaison program, also provides assistance and help to historically underserved producers. So there are three ways of us helping create that avenue. We will also be announcing in the near term additional resources with groups to try to figure out how we can encourage additional access to markets and land for that same group. And so that's coming in the very near future.
Thank you.
You bet. All right, thank you all very much. Sure, you bet, absolutely.